Hello and welcome to Let's Read the Books of Daggerfall. I'm Amethyst Lunatari. Today I'll be reading King Edward Part 8, which I bought right here at the Adventurer's Bookseller in Longwich Commons, which is in Alesson Hills. King Edward Part 8, Chapter 8, Wilderland. The journey through Valenwood was pleasant. The weather held fair for the most part, with sunny days and cool nights. Bright leaves of scarlet, crimson, gold, and green drifted down to form a carpet beneath their horses' feet. Valenwood was very different from the somber, steep forests of High Rock. When they reached the northern border, Edward, looking back, saw that the trees were mostly bare, shorn of their glory. Before them lay a wild, green land of rolling hills with only a few stands of trees. It seemed to spread on forever. "This is Wilderland, Edward," Moreland said. "Be on your guard. It seems a pleasant land, but no king's writ runs here. Each man's hand is against every other's, and they are worse than men. All the races of Tamriel meet here and clash, save thine, perhaps." They journeyed for some days more with small incident, save one for a band of Khajiit raiders that crept up on their camp at night. They were easily repelled. Silk slew one, and the rest ran off yowling. The gentle wood elf girl, Willow, lobbed fireballs after them. There were no roads, just small paths that crisscrossed one another and seemingly led nowhere. After 2 weeks of steady riding, they came to a bowl-shaped place in the hills where the land was tilled. The fields looked fair and were stacked with harvest, but the folk were dispirited, ragged, and unfriendly. Questions about inns got only shrugs and puzzled looks. Armed bands challenged them at times and demanded to know their business. When Moreland said they were bound for Morrowind, they were told to pass through quickly, and mind they stole nothing. "Passage is all we wish," Moreland said quietly. "Someone should teach these folk manners," the usually placid Mats growled. "Thou mayst stay and open a school of etiquette, if it pleases thee," Moreland said. "I fear my life's too short to teach the lessons these villains require. Still, I like not the look of the sky. It looks even more evil than the folk. I think we'll try our luck in the town." The town was surrounded by a palisade of wood and had a stout gate. Guards looked them over and refused them entrance. "None but humans enter here, elf. Take thy rabble and be gone." "I see. Allie, Mats, Edward, thou seemst to qualify for the hospitality here. The rest of us will shelter elsewhere." Alira announced that she would see them all blown back to Firsthold by the storm before which she'd step between these gates. So they circled the town, passing a moat with stone walls within and a keep of some sort within that. A track north took them past a small house with a large barn nearby. Both looked in poor repair, but Moreland sent Alira and Edward to knock at the door and asked if they might sleep in the barn. The rest waited in the road. An elderly woman answered their knock. She looked pleased to see them. "Stay? Aye, I'd be glad of the company. No need to sleep in the barn, though, lady. I've a room to spare. My name's Aura Engelsdotter." Alira gestured toward the waiting companions. The woman squinted toward them. "Thy man's there and some friends? Aye, we'll all squeeze together, then. 'Twill be warmer, so. I've a pot of soup on the fire. Made it to last me a week, but you're welcome to it. I can make more." "My husband's an elf." "Is he so? He looks to take good care of thee and thy son. Thou's fat as pigs. Bring them in. I wish my granddaughter had a one to care for her." Aura refused payment, saying she was not yet at such a pass that her guests must pay for her hospitality. She said tales and song and an evening's merriment would be payment enough. Pots and dishes were set out to catch the worst of the leaks. She knew them all well. They gathered around the hearth and made very merry while the storm raged, banging the shutters and doors and threatening to blow the roof away altogether. "Tell me, my lady," Aura whispered apart to Alira, "he's truly good to thee? He's so big and so black." "Truly good," Alira said, keeping her mouth serious while her eyes laughed. "Aye, 'tis well then. He put me a bit in mind of our baron, who's big and dark. Oh, not so dark as thy elf. He took my granddaughter, Karen, and he does not treat her well. He hurts her, my lady, and she dare not run away. Where would she go? Tears gathered in Aura's eyes and followed worn, familiar tracks down her cheeks. When their hostess had gone to sleep in her own room, Alira repeated what she had been told. "Let's rescue the girl," Beat said. "We go stale with inaction." "Aye," said Silk and Willow at once. Mats growled in agreement. Myth and Saas looked interested. Morlin looked doubtful. "We cannot right every wrong in Tamriel. This baron offers his folk shelter of a kind. They could leave if they liked it better outside." "Aye," Myth said. "He keeps the bandits off so he may rob the folk at leisure." "And we pull him down? There'll be another to take his place, or else the outside will come in and there'll be nothing left at all." "Nothing would be better than this filthy something," Matt said. "There's that." The storm seemed to have moved away. Alira went to the door and stared up into the sky, where clouds raced past the eastern moon. A single large, brilliant blue star hung near the moon. "Zenithra hangs near Tamriel tonight, Morlin?" "I'd thought to mend her roofs tomorrow if it's fair," he said as she returned to the fireside. "We'll do so much, at least. As for the rest, Alira?" "She asked for my help, in a way, and I think I hear Zenithar's voice in the wind, and feel his hand in the rain on this night." "Thy quest then, wife?" Alira nodded, unsmiling. She curled up with Morlin in the chimney corner, and they whispered and laughed together for a while. Edward fell asleep. In the morning he was sent up on the roof to help Beech and Willow place new shingles. Morlin wrote a letter which he gave to Mats, telling him to take it to the Baron, to arrive at the castle around dinner time, and to go afoot. "You going to challenge him for the girl?" Edward grinned. "But will he fight? And wouldn't he take her back against once we're gone?" "Since he wouldn't let me in his town, thy mother thought to invite him to our house instead." Morlin stamped the letter with his sealing ring and handed it to Mats. "Oh, it's a long way to your house still, isn't it?" Edward felt a bit disappointment that no rescue seemed imminent, but he supposed it really was not reasonable to expect 8 people to take a keep, even if they were Morlin's companions. Perhaps the songs exaggerated their deeds. Morlin grinned, ruffled Edward's hair, and told him to cease his questions, get up on the roof, and mind his mother. Morlin and Myth set off together on foot. Alira said they were going hunting. They did not return, even at supper time. Alira told Edward not to worry. They'd meet later. It was well after sundown when she bid their hostess farewell. They took all the horses with them and left them in a grove near the north wall of the keep. Alira asked Edward if he wanted to wait for them with the horses. Edward asked where they were going. "We have to enter the keep to get Aura's grandchild out. No questions, Edward. If you're coming, then stay with me and do exactly as I say. Levitate across the moat. I must swim. Once across, we'll scale the wall. Once inside, just follow me and be as silent as you can." Edward gaped at his mother and the other companions. How could the 6 of them possibly storm a keep? 3 women, 2 men, and a boy? There would be guards up on the wall, and a lot more inside. Mats would be inside too, though, he guessed. But where were Morlin and Myth? There were fearsome things in the moat. Edward began a protest, then thought better of it. Saas slid into the moat first. There was some splashing and hissing, then the water went quiet. Alira entered the water. The others levitated. "Here's the ropes," Beech said, feeling along the wall. There were 3 ropes. Edward, Beech, and Saas went up first. Alira, Willow, and Silk followed. Morlin and Myth were waiting above. 2 guards were snoring softly in a heap. "How?" Edward began, and found his mother's hand clapped over his mouth. A guard from another wall section called out, and Edward's heart stopped beating. Myth called something back to him, and trampling footsteps moved away. The companions went silently down the stairs and slipped across the yard like shadows. There was no guard on the door to the keep itself. Inside, the passages were eerily quiet. They stopped at an imposing door and flattened themselves against the wall beside it. They could hear voices within. A thin, chilling wail sounded and died away. Morlin whistled a snatch of song into the silence that followed. The door swung open, and they raced inside, falling on the startled guards like furies. Edward was last inside. tooth in his hand, he stabbed the nearest guard in the side, and Beach finished him with a blow to the head. Mats had been inside. It was he who opened the door. His axe clove the head of one guard, then swung against the inner door. Alira and Willow had barred the strong outer door. Moreland's opponent was a very young man. He'd taken one look at the big dark elf, dropped his sword, and fallen to his knees, praying for mercy. Moreland eyed him with disgust and said, "Greet Senator for me. Tell him Moreland of Ebonheart commends you to his mercy. I have none for such as you." He slashed the young guard's throat. Blood sprayed over Moreland's leathers. His victim fell over, gurgling horribly. A burning acid rose in Edward's throat. He swallowed hard and looked away. The guards inside the anteroom had been dispatched, but outside the door shouts and footfalls thundered, and there was pounding on the door. Edward followed his mother into the inner chamber, which was empty save for a naked girl tied spread-eagle on the enormous bed, her eyes starting from her head. The companions cut her free, while Alira caught her shoulders. "Thy grandmother sent us, child. Where's the Baron?" The girl pointed at a bookcase, then clung to Alira. She was no bigger than Edward, and seemed not much older. Her breasts were just beginning. She was covered with welts and blood and purple-yellow bruises. Alira flung her own cloak over the girl. Beach picked her up. Myth's fingers were feeling over the bookcase. There was a click, and a section slid aside. He went through cautiously. The others followed, and the secret door closed after them. "I think it's just a bolt hole," Myth said, "but there'll be traps, no doubt." "Go warily, then, friend," Alira said. "There's no hurry. I think the Baron plans to show his departing guests the door, as a good host should." A narrow passage opened to the left. Myth sent a bolt of light down it. The floor was littered with bones, human bones. Small skulls stared eyelessly. "I'm going to enjoy killing him," Moreland said. "No," Alira protested. "My quest. My kill." Moreland swung to face her. "Alira, I want it sung that he died by Alira's hand. I claim my right to face him, King." "Leave him to me and we'll sing it your way. He's twice your size. Do you want to fight me for the right?" The elf leaned over her, a full head taller. "If I must..." Alira brushed past him, slinging her shield on her arm and drawing her short sword as she ran. Moreland grabbed at her, missed, and ran after her. His size hampered him in the low, narrow passage. Sparks flew from his spell shield as he caromed recklessly off the halls. "Come, you two," Myth yelled from ahead. "I'm not promising to save him for you." "Moreland," Edward gasped, running after him. "You're not going to let her." "Let her? How do you suppose I stop her? I'm open to suggestions, short of actually fighting her myself." He seemed half angry, half amused. Maybe he's gone by now." "Nay, he's locked in here with us. We found the exit earlier from the other side, and Myth set a lock the Baron will not undo." "Well, paralyze her. You can carry her." "She's activated her shield. It reflects spells, among other things. I'd only paralyze myself, and it'd be inconvenient to carry. She'll be all right. It's an excellent shield. It casts a very powerful protective spell. Eric himself devised it." "Having a spot of trouble with your locks tonight, Baron?" Myth's voice came clearly from ahead. They'd emerged into a larger space where the Baron had been clawing vainly at switches beside a massive door. "Shoddy work. You should get another smith." "He won't be needing one," Alira snarled. The companions spread around her in a semicircle. The Baron set his back to the door and set himself in a fighting stance. He was a big man, as big as Matt's, and he was holding an axe as big as the one Matt's wielded, and wearing a breastplate and helm. He addressed Moreland. "Nine against one. I'd expect odds like that from you black devils." Moreland was at the back of the group, yet the Baron had singled him out as the leader. People did, somehow. "You prefer the advantage of weight, do you not? But my wife wants you to herself. She cannot resist your charms, it seems. Nor can I. I could not wait for you to respond to my invitation, so I came to you instead." "I beat her and the rest of you kill me? Ha! It might be worth it at that," he added, staring at Alira with cold, dark eyes. Alira smiled a terrible smile. Her dark hair swung free about her shoulders, and she seemed to glow. "You will not beat this woman, Baron, but if you do, then you go free." "You are mine alone tonight. Swear it all by Xanathar. If he happens to kill me, my ghost will hound him to his grave and beyond. She sounded rather pleased at the prospect. Edward began to shiver. By Xanathar! The Baron laughed. I don't believe you, but one last female for my collection, then. Are you so wearied of her, Elf? Are you so afraid of her that you'd rather face me instead? Somewhere deep in his mind, Edward realized that the Elf was right. Despite the Baron's bravado, he was afraid of Alira. Edward hadn't sworn with the others. He clutched his staff lightly, but his feet seemed rooted to the floor. The Baron laughed again and swung a mighty blow at Alira in answer, but it deflected harmlessly off her shield. Her eyes widened as he realized she was spell-shielded. Alira danced aside and cut his arm. She was nimble, but he managed to land many blows. If her shield went... Edward did not finish the thought. But he was leaving himself somewhat open, in the hope of wearing her shield down, and she was scoring hits against his limbs. She kept her blows low, trying to cost him the use of his legs and drain him of blood. All the while she taunted him about his manhood, saying she would geld him ere he died. A great blow knocked her back. Her shield flashed and was gone. The Baron raised his axe high enough to cleave her skull with a single blow. Her arm drew back, and she threw her slender short sword straight into her enemy's eye. He dropped the axe and fell screaming to his knees, hands clawing at his face. Alira stepped forward and thrust the sword home, piercing deep within the brain. The body fell over, twitching and jerking. "Well fought, wife. I had a master trainer and a better armorer." Alira laughed, then she threw back her head and shouted wordlessly in triumph, raising her arms, fist clenched. "That you did." Morlin grabbed Silk in a rough hug and kissed her noisily. "It's a neat trick you taught her, Silk." "I'll thank you to cease flirting with my trainer, husband," Alira said, wiping her slender adamantium blade carefully. "Me flirt? Not while thy blood's up and thy shield's still charged. I'm just thanking her. I'll kiss Eric, too, when next I see him." "Is he truly dead?" Karen had clung to Beach throughout the fight with her eyes closed. Now she regarded Alira with awe, Edward thought was the right word. Edward felt something of the same, although it was akin to horror. "Dead enough," Alira said, regarding the still faintly twitching form with satisfaction. The girl drew closer, then knelt beside him. She picked up a stone and smashed it into the face again and again, sobbing. When she had done, Sa'as cast some healing spells on her. Myth unlocked the door. They'd come out quite near to where they had left the horses. They took the girl back to her mother's house and left her there, instructing her to tell anyone that ventured to molest her that Xanathar's servants would return if she were harmed. The bewildered old woman clasped her granddaughter to her. As she bade them farewell, she whispered to Alira to look after that man of hers. "Oh, I do," Alira said. "I do." When they stopped for rest, Alira came over to Edward to talk to him, but he protested that he was very tired and just wanted to sleep. Merlin tugged her away, saying that if her son did not need her, then she could see to her man who did. They moved out of the circle of firelight. Edward lay wakeful, listening to their small, stifled sounds. That was not unusual. It had troubled him at first. "I can't sleep. You're too noisy," he protested one night. "What are you doing, anyway?" That had drawn giggles from the companions. "Can't you at least pretend you're sleeping?" Morlin had asked plaintively. "Now I know why dark elves seldom have more than one child. What I do not understand is how humans manage to get so many." Morlin and Alira had come back to lie by him that night, but after that he had pretended to sleep, like the others. And the noises were too familiar now to keep images of the night's adventures from flashing through his mind, as vivid as they were happening again in truth. He could feel his Daedra feeding. It could not stop it. It just wasn't fair, he thought. But now he was beginning to see what Morlin meant by feeding his Daedra and yet walking with the gods, with Xanathar. Morlin came back, carrying Alira. He set her gently down, then stretched himself out between Edward and her. "It must be difficult, being a woman," he said softly. "It was hard, watching her. Just watching." Edward nodded. "I've asked it often enough of her," Moreland continued. She told me how hard it is, but I never knew until tonight. I knew she'd win. Xenothor was with her, and all the Baron had was his Daedra. And still, it was very hard to watch. She makes that cast 9 tries out of 10, and there were more uses on the shield if she missed. He might have dropped of exhaustion before he wore it out entirely. I keep thinking about it, too. And the guard you... He asked for mercy? I know. And yet, he listened to that, night after night, and still he remained the Baron's man. Most men are not as strong as you are. Maybe he couldn't help himself? Why was he pleading for a man already dead? His mind kept replaying the night's events as if they might yet come out differently, for better or for worse. Even to witness evil such as that corrupts the soul. To watch and do nothing? Mats would have stayed my hand had there been anything there worth keeping. And it's worse for the young. I am sorry you had to pass through this night. Is my soul corrupted now? You feel the acid's bite, as do we all, but you'll heal. Can you heal me now? Aye. Moreland gathered the boy in his arms, then rolled over so that Edward lay between his parents. Illyria put her arms around him, without really waking. Her strong woman's smell mingled with Moreland's musky dark spice odor in Edward's nostrils. She was so angry, Edward whispered. He wondered if he would ever really feel the same toward her again, and yet her arms were still as comforting as before. Maybe Moreland, too, had needed that reassurance and had been wise enough to ask for it. She's a woman. That sort of injury to another touches her near, he said. How near? The boy looked the question he dared not put. Thy father's not a monster, but she was wed to a man who did not care for her, and she could not leave him. It's common enough among thy race, which makes it none the easier to bear, I think. She has a Daedra too, then? Edward asked sadly. You must speak with her about that. It wasn't really a fair fight, her shielded and not him. Fair fighting's for the arena, boy. Would you fight a wolf or a hellhound without weapons, spells, and armor, though they have not? I think not. What will become of Karen and Aura, and the other folk, now that the Baron's dead? Do I look like the Prophet Maruk? How should I know? We can stop here in the spring and see what's been planted in the field we burned tonight. I've no mind to stay and plow it. I've my own fields to tend. Listen to me. I sound like a Nord farmer. Mine's to dig is more like it, he yawned. The others didn't think about it afterwards. You did. I'm a king. It's what we do. Thank you for listening to Let's Read the Books of Daggerfall, King Edward, Part 8.